Hey, I'm Jay, and I'm a DM. And I've been busy for a while, so I haven't made any new diary entries. So today, four different sessions put together. 16, 17, 18, and 19. In short, we finished up chapter 3, I believe. And we did our own little way, of course. So I'll tell you what's different and such. Also, I don't remember everything anymore because, like, one of these sessions was like almost 2 months ago. So today might be a little bit more rambly than I'm comfortable with, but I will see. I will do my best. So, now with that all out of the way, first up, session 16. This session started exactly where we left off, in the tavern, the Whistling Whale. Last time, the time god Labolas Anaret froze time, and today we started with time starting up again. And this session the players retrace their steps and witnessed the impact their actions had. So the warlock missed the time god session. So he was very confused about all the shenanigans that were going on. And it felt a little bit mean to me for a while. But luckily, eventually the warlock got everything figured out. So, the pieces started to click together. Also, I think the other two players had fun, seeing what their actions, what the consequences were of them. The orphans, for example, they now have heads of the sky self. And they also have a bunch of gold, and they are also now wanted for attempting to murder a nobleman, even though that wasn't their fault, but the players. So that's fun. And we also have now a shield guardian on the road that went rogue. So all kind of fun shenanigans. And the nimble right Nim, he plays a big part in this adventure, in this chapter at least. Is damaged because the players pushed him out of a window. So from a balcony. But tomato, boat go splash if you drop them to from a second story building. One encountered the one with the wizard and the pirates. I played up it's a while ago since when they got there. So everyone we had moved on. So they didn't really discover anything there. I do think, especially the wizard player, was a little bit disappointed about not really finding anything new in that particular encounter, because that wizard is his apprentice, all the way around. The wizard player is an apprentice to the wizard NPC, and yeah, I kind of skipped this thing. But yeah, overall everything went, every encounter went pretty well. And we even never had time for one last encounter. The other Nim, Nimble Right, Nim's twin. Today I ran for the first time a chase scene. And that was pretty fun. The fighter chased after the Nimble Right. But unfortunately, he chased the Nimbleride into the butterfly garden of the Castellanters, and the Castellanter family took the Nimbleride prisoner. Anyway, the chasing was a fun thing, and I will definitely try to run chasings more often. I need a little bit more practice. They are a little bit finicky. At least if you want to prevent the you move 25 feet, he moves 30 feet turn after turn without ever anything. So what I did was make some sort of skill check. And succeed, you get closer. Fail, well, you get fall behind. And then a couple of key clicks. That will give the outcome of the case. I will need a little bit more practice in the future, but. Yeah, they are fun, so I will definitely keep them in mind. The case did unfortunately fail, as I mentioned, but luckily the other two players they caught up with the original Nim, and Nim promised to take them to where the Stone of Glory was. Playing Nim was fun, because well, in the book he can't speak common, and because he was damaged also, I played it up like his gears are a little bit stuck, but they do make a clicking sound, and so one of my players came up with the idea with like one click is yes, two click is no, is a no, and so we communicated that way. That was a fun puzzle. Yeah, that was a very fun thing to do. One final mistake today I think I made. When the fighter was like at the gate of the Castellanters, I had like their nanny, the tiefling nanny. I tried to make her flirt with him, but I'm afraid it came off a little bit creepy, and that was not my intention. So that's a shame. But that also makes and that was like where the session ended. And that brings us to today's conclusion of our case scenes are cool. Seeing the real impact players have is cool, so I have to do that more often also. And less creepy flirting. That was my conclusion of this session. And well, that means we can move on to session 17. In this session, the party followed Nim to the last known location of the Stone of Glory, namely the Grelhund Estate. The place was heavily guarded, so the players needed a plan. And also, since Nim helped them, the fighter decided to fix Nim's broken gears. Overall, I don't really remember much of this session, so I will keep it short. Playing Nim was still was fun, and it will always be fun, I think. Probably keeping him around longer than he probably should. About the Grelhund situation. No concrete plan formed yet in this session, and this will also be a problem in session 19, as you will see that then. But even though they didn't the party didn't get a full plan yet, they did get make a couple of starting points. For example, twist that came up with the idea to get a scroll of the spell locate object to confirm the stone is indeed here. And the party also decided to get René and Neverember involved. Because he was like the original guy who gave them the quest to get the stone. The fighter went to the workshop of his brother to fix the Nimbrite Nim. And the cliffhanger I ended on was that his long-lost sister showed up, also at the workshop. Because the fighter had left a note in her pocket during the frozen time scene. So yeah, that was a cliffhanger for the next session. For the conclusion time of the session 17, I can be very short. I don't really remember anything. So the lesson I'm taking away here is make more memorable sessions. So session 18, this session we started with a character interaction I have already been looking forward for since we even started the campaign, since the players made their characters. The fighter in particular, I already looked forward to this encounter, and I kinda mucked it up. So we started with the confrontation between the fighter and his sister. And I kinda stumbled through it. First off, I fumbled some names that she should probably remember, but I had just completely blanked on them. There is a kind of in-world reason why she might have forgotten those names, but I don't think I'm a good enough actor yet to have pulled off pretending to be confused, you know? I don't think my players bought that Yvonne here was the confused one instead of me, because we both were. You know what I mean? Also, I didn't I didn't yet properly establish her like motivation to be here and her personality. So that's also a little bit a stumbling block I encountered. And I also in the fighter's backstory he has like a dwarven friend that she should know, but I kinda as DM completely forgot about this dwarf friend. In my defense kind of thing. The fighter's backstory has a lot of characters in it. Like a very large family, a friend, a rival, a criminal contact by the Zentrum, also even a cat that's a stray cat that he likes. So yeah, it's a very dense. There is a lot of stuff going on in his backstory. And I know I don't have to use it all, and I don't even I don't think my player expects me to use it all. But I do think, you know, the favorite parts. I think he would like to see his favorite parts of his backstory show up in the campaign, you know. And I'm also worried that his favorite parts of the backstory are not necessarily the same as my favorite parts of his backstory. And so I am worried a little bit misaligned maybe. Because that dwarf friend, for example, I'm pretty sure he that dwarven friend has been mentioned twice now, and I, yeah, thrice in total, forgot completely about that dwarf. So, yeah, that's a little bit a shame. I also changed his backstory a little bit, and I'm not entirely convinced my player is fine with it. His sister was supposed to be a bard in Down on Hollak, and so I took that from, aha! Since she's a bard down on Hollak, what if she took up pirating, you know, as a side job? And there's a very very particular reason, of course, why I chose her to be a pirate. And if you are familiar with Waterdeep Dragon Heist, you already know why, probably. But that's to make a link between, you know, the parties and the party and a certain lovable pirate. Anyway. Meanwhile, the wizard was getting that scroll of locate object, and I believe he also used it this session, but that might have been next session. I'm not entirely sure anymore about that. Anyway, whenever it was, he did discover that the Stone of Glory is indeed there. He also discovered that the Stone of Glory is can communicate telepathically, so that was a shocker. And the Stone of Glory meanwhile discovered that he was not the first being that you know, infiltrated the wizard's mind. So since there was, like, way early on, the mind flayer did this also to the wizard. Anyway, the campaign, even though I did stumble with like the pirate bard sister, which I think is a shame, the campaign isn't over yet, so I still have plenty of chances for class second chances to you know, do cool stuff. Which this brings us to the conclusion of this particular session. And I think my conclusion is that I should probably just ask my players what their favorite parts are of their backstories. Because then I can, like, highlight the parts my players actually want to have highlighted, you know? With that, we are at session 19. The last session I will do in this particular video. And the last session we did in this chapter. We started at the doorstep of the Grelhund Manor. And the party had confirmed that the Stone of Glory was here on the second floor. And they also had discovered that the stone was telepathic. Now what remained to they had to do was get the stone. But our heroes did struggle with making a plan. And after a few attempts, they did settle on the easiest, simplest solution: just smash the window, grab the stone, and make a run for it. That plan went off without a hitch, except that maybe the Lady Yala Grelhund, she might have spotted the fighter and the other thieves. So, alright, this session was a little bit, it was quite rough, I felt like, at least. Not really rough in a, like, a combat kind of way, but in a plan making kind of way, because yeah, as I in the just alluded already, the party really struggled with getting a plan together. So why was that? Well, I think there were a couple of reasons. It was why it was so difficult to make a plan. First off, let's start with the big one. That's kinda completely my fault, and also already happened during the prep of the session. As you can see here, there are a lot of tokens on the board. And in fact, there are two tokens of two different factions, the Zentarim in with the red round red circles, and the and another faction, the Grelhund family and their servants and the guards and stuff. The Grelhund family in blue. Also, these two are technically the Castellanters. I will be quick about them. I threw them kinda in as a semi-random encounter because I thought halfway during the session, because I thought that would spice things up, but not quite. But so yeah, that was their part. I will move them to the side. So yeah, there are two factions here, and that's here's kind of where the change comes in that I made to the book that kind of big misfired on me. If you go by the book, these two have like a very tenuous alliance, and by the book, when the party arrives, that alliance has broken down, and they had like a massive combat in the manor, and well, most people are dead, and so the party encounters a lot less people here. But I thought it would be that's a little bit passive, so I thought it would be more interesting to have my party directly involved in starting the conflict between the two, or maybe using it while they are fighting, etc. Unfortunately, that didn't quite go as planned. The part is, I never started off a combat between the two factions. Without input from the players, I didn't feel like starting it, because if you're just having a massive combat between yourself, your own tokens, then you're just playing with yourself. Dus if you pardon the pun. And that's not what I want. Which I think then brings me to a related problem why I didn't really get much input from my players. And that's something I like to call the what do you do loop. That's when a DM, in me in this case, is like, what do you want to do? And the players, logically respond with, I don't know, what can we do? Or what should we do? And the DM's response to that again is, pretty much anything you want, so what do you do? That cycle, sometimes people then get stuck in that sort of cycle. And that's what happened here, I feel like. With this many guards, I think my players really struggled to find an obvious way in. And because my players didn't really find a way in, I didn't really know how to sneakily move the pawns around so they could take advantage from that way in, And that way, neither of us really knew how to move forward, I think, and that's why we kind of got stuck for a bit. Eventually, the party did come up with a few minor plans that were pretty fine. The warlock, for example, he came up with an idea to make a sound with, I think, minor illusion, but don't quote me on that. Like a loud sound here, so that the guards were distracted and came looking that way. The fighter came up with the idea to become invisible and sneak in through the back door. And the wizard, at some point, he used the telepathy and his infernal. If you, I believe the language is infernal, not abyssal. The two I do sometimes mix up, but that's not. I'm pretty sure it's infernal. And it talked like in the head of a maid. The maid mistook him for Asmodeus. And this way, both the player and in and out of character learned who Asmodeus was, which especially the out of character surprised me. I kind of presumed that Asmodeus is a pretty famous Dungeons and Dragons god, so I thought everyone knew who he was, but apparently not. And well, I got someone in the real world to learn something, so that's fun. If you don't know, Asmodeus is like the devil in D&D. Anyway, so yeah, three pretty decent plans. I did unfortunately mess up with one, like when the fighter was sneaking, invisible. I thought, you know what? Let's throw in a complication, and that was my mistake here. I made like the main guy, Urstel Floxin, make like a sniffing sound, like I smell something. Something's off here. And then the fighter fled away. So yeah, we were making he was making some good progress, and then I chased it away. And yeah, with hindsight of 2020, I should not have throw in that complication, because the session was har already hard enough so far, and you know, then you don't need complications. Complications are fun, they make things encounters interesting, but yeah, you only need them. You should only use them probably when things are going yeah, well, everyone's still in the mood, you know. At this point, I think everyone was a little bit tired. Me, at least, I was definitely. So, this was a bad call by me. Finally, the players just kinda went with the plan. Screw it! They just smashed the windows here and grabbed the stone. Made a getaway. I did make it like that. Lady Yala snapped, like saw them, maybe, potentially, question mark, don't know. Whatever is more interesting for the story later on, I guess. That's probably something I should not admit in public, but whatever. There is one final thing. I think my fighter sometimes forgets he's a member of the Zentrum. Because this is not the first time we encountered Zentrum people, and I was like, do you want to do something with them, fighter? I mean, they are in your faction. The player is like, nah. So, I don't know if that's what it is, if that's like, nope. If yeah, I don't know. He I honestly now I'm just blabbing. Yeah, I don't know why kinda ignores the other Zentrum agents. But that's a problem for another time to think about. So yeah, today's conclusion is don't put too many enemies everywhere. Well, everywhere, somewhere. And also, I kinda designed this building to be like a fortress. To have deliberately no entrances at the sides. And that was probably a mistake too. I probably should also just, less enemies, not too much enemies, and enough ways to like get into places. That's today's conclusion. So, and do I have a conclusion for the four sessions in total? Yes, I do, and that is that I need to keep up with my work. Not just in D&D, but also in real life. I'm getting behind in some stuff, and this was. It was fun to make, but it was also not fun to make a video with half an hour long, and four sessions. A four session recap. That was not. This was less pleasant than it should have been. Or at least it was a lot more work than I'm happy with. Cheers.